with another case presentation, and in this case we're going to combine an immediate implant placement with the crown lengthening procedure. And this is the tooth that we are going to replace during this presentation. So what we have a young patient that have a history of internal bleaching and something went wrong, and actually she have a very severe external resorption, and this is a tooth that I cannot save. The main complaints of the patient is that she have some pus coming out and inflammation from time to time in this area. Additionally, the patient have a gingival smile, she's showing a lot of gums, and what you can see during the planning is that the width to crown ratio of the crown is not perfect, they're almost squarish, and we know from the literature that the ratio should be between 75% to 80%. And this is something that we need to plan during the before the surgery, so we can put the implant in a position that is related to the desired length of the natural teeth. If you see on the CBCT, and we did the CBCT for the implant placement, the natural crown of the teeth is in a very good proportion. That means that we have a discrepancy here between the anatomical crown that is given and the clinical crown, because the tissue is covering the clinical crown and it looks shorter. And this is another way to see if there is a discrepancy between the clinical and the anatomical crown. If you don't have the CBCT, you can use a small piece of gutta percha that is for endodontic treatment. You attach this on the tooth and the tip of the gutta percha is just touching the gingival margin. And when you make a simple x-ray, you can see the difference between the gingival margin. You don't see it, but you see where is the tip of the gutta percha and the enamel that is on the natural crown. And this is a picture during the surgery when I extract the tooth. You can see the difference between the anatomical crown of the extracted tooth, and it is almost the same crown on the natural tooth, but it's not visible because this is covered with the soft tissue. So we're going to start with the extraction of the tooth, and the main thing when we are doing immediate implant placement for me is to keep the papillas intact. So I'm paying a lot of attention to keep the papillas in place, to keep the papillas attached to the neighboring teeth and not to damage the papilla in any way. So first I'm going to use a small blade that is a Hugh Freddy blade. I'm just detaching the soft tissue from the tooth, the supracrestal ligaments, and here because of the resorption in some places I need to go deeper. This is a VT1 instrument that is from Deppler. I'm using this to make a small walk section of the teeth, and then I will try to very gently grab the crown with the forceps. And I was lucky in this case because the crown, the tooth come as a whole, it doesn't break. And another thing that I will do initially, you can see here how much soft tissue is attached to the root, and maybe we need to clean a lot this socket. It's not like a regular immediate implant placement. We have a lot of soft tissue there that in my opinion we should remove. Additionally, I'm gonna reshape the composites here. I didn't know it before the surgery, after because otherwise we will first start with the composite restorations, but here I saw this in regular restoration during the surgery and I immediately correct with a small burr. This is the tooth, and you can see that it's not savable, at least in my hands. We did the planning with Emil Bobe from MSOFT, and what we're looking here is that we have enough bone to place the implant to have a primary stability. Additionally, we're looking for the access hole in order to create a screw retain restoration if it's possible, because this is my preference. And additionally, I don't want my transmucosal components to go close to the papilla or to the buccal area, or if I go too much to the palate, then we have another problem because the crown will be thick on the palate and the patient will need to get used to this. And I have a lot of complaints from the patients when the palatal part of the crown is too bulky. This is the MGUIDE that I receive from the MGUIDE. You can see how good it fits. And after we check the MGUIDE, we can proceed with implant placement. So first I need to clean the socket, and in this case I'm using a combination of blade, curettes, this is Lucas curette, and additionally I'm going to use a big round burr, like I think it's a green burr, in order to remove the pocket epithelium. And remember, it's a case with an external resorption that is infected, so we have an epithelium that is going inside the socket. So here I'm checking the position of the drills when I'm drilling. So I make the first drill, then I look through the microscope and I see if the osteotomy is going to the palate. And this is something that is additional, it's not in the original protocol. I'm using the initial burr from the original set, it's not from the guided set, and I'm going just a bit deeper, because in this case it's very hard to plan the vertical position of the implant, because we need to relate it not to the soft tissue margin but to the natural teeth. And you're gonna see this in a minute. So this is the protocol for the MGUIDE, the MGUIDE in place, the yellow and the red burrs, drills, and the maybe the main point here is that with the last drill I don't go to the end in order to achieve an optimal primary stability. Then we need to perform the crown lengthening, and it consists of two parts, the soft tissue part and the bone part of the crown lengthening. For the, I start with the soft tissue part before I position my implant, because I need to have a reference for the depth of the implant, because we need to put the implant in a very good depth related to the crowns of the natural teeth. So first I expose the crowns using the electrosurgical device, then using this reference we're going to insert the implant, and after we insert the implant we need to check again what is the depth of this implant. And remember, in this case we're not going to relate the depth of the implant to the existing soft tissue margin, but we are going to use the soft tissue margin of the collateral incisor that we just expose with the crown lengthening procedure. And here, in order to achieve 3 to 4 millimeter depth of the implant, we need to go 5-6 millimeters from the soft tissue margin that is existing. We are not going to remove this soft tissue, we're going to keep it there because it's going to be in excess and it's going to compensate for the shrinkage that we're going to have. In order to perform the bone part of the crown lengthening, here I'm going to raise to make a small tunneling flap to be able to access the bone without damaging the soft tissue with the burn or with the curettes. Nowadays I'm using piezo devices like VNH, and with this I'm able to perform it even easier. But back in the days I needed to use like a manual or rotating instruments, and for this I need to create a small tunneling flap. So you can see here with the blade I'm just releasing the papilla just to have access to the bone there. And through the microscope you will be able to see very nicely where is the CEJ of the natural tooth and where is the bone, and which part of the bone I need to remove in order to recreate the biological width. So here is the CEJ of the tooth, and from here we need to have 3 millimeters, so this bone I will have to remove, and I'm going to use a curette or a small rotating instruments for this. So this is how I work with the curette. You need to put some pressure, and in the same time you need to be gentle to the soft tissue. So now with the piezoelectric instruments it's easier to be done. It's the same on the lateral, and you need to perform the same procedure on the canine and on the canine and the lateral on the other side. This is the situation immediately after the surgery, and just in this case I put a small like one suture on every papilla just to able to have a more stable situation. Normally during the flapless crown lengthening you don't need to put sutures, but just in this case the papillas are moving a little bit too much, that's why I apply additional suturing. You can see now that the soft tissue is in excess on the implant side, and that's why we don't need to use additional connective tissue graft. This is a very rare case that we are not using a connective tissue graft when we are performing an immediate implant placement, just because we have an excess of the soft tissue. This is after the healing, after 4 months, and now what we need to do is this excessive soft tissue that is vertically to push it apically, and this we will perform in two steps. The first step is me putting a composite on the screw retained restoration, and the second step is in the lab. So in the first step I'm editing some composite in order to push and reform the gingival margin, and I do these steps like 10 days apart, and you can see on the day 28 I already achieve almost the same height and almost the same form of the gingival margin. And I achieve, this is the first step, I try to achieve like 90% of the form of the zenith. And then we go to the lab, we transfer this emergence profile in the lab, and here is the second step where my technician, in this case is Stefan Petrov, he performed with the burr, he transformed, reshaped the artificial gingiva and create the last 10% of the form. He used a burr to create exactly the same profile, and then he copied this in the final restoration. So this is the day of the insertion of the final crown, and you can see that the gingiva is not perfect, and when we remove, you can see that it's not a perfect zenith line, it's not a perfect gingival outline, and you can see the effect when we screw inside the restoration. Because it's the last 10%, we immediately change the form of the gingiva using the form of the restoration. So this is when we screw the crown, and you can see how it's changing immediately. So this is the follow-up of the case. The implant is integrated, it's a very nice x-ray. I really like the bone formation around the implant, and most of all you can see the symmetry and the harmony of the soft tissue. And remember, in this case we didn't use a connective tissue graft because we have an excessive soft tissue, because we performed the crown lengthening only on the neighboring teeth, and in this place we kept the soft tissue excess, and then we reshape it in two steps. This is the follow-up of the case, the lateral view. Most important is to see one more time what was the key element here. We performed the crown lengthening on the rest of the dentition. Here we saved the excess of the soft tissue, we saved, and then we manage in order to create a nice gingival outline and perfect emergence profile without using a connective tissue graft. This is the pictures of before and after, and you can see how we were able to expose the natural, the anatomical crown of the patient, and this reduced the gingival smile, it improves the harmony, and we have a better proportions of the teeth. This is the new gingival outline here, and you can see the effect that we have on the face. So with this, my dear friends and colleagues, I want to thank you for your patience, and hope to see you soon again. Bye.